The Polestar 3 is a radical break from the previous car from the stable, the Polestar 2. It's built on Volvo's SPA2 chassis and is clearly positioned towards the luxury segment with its design of huge fenders that curve over and wide of the front trunk. The eye-catching streamlined roofline and its Swedish design that are instantly visible. A quick shout to Tyler and the team at Polestar San Jose for having me. I'm presenting my early impressions and thoughts here. The Polestar 3 is 192.9 inches in length, 83.5 inches wide, with folded mirrors, and 64.1 inches in height. It has a rear cargo capacity of roughly 21 cubic feet and a frunk of 1.1 cubic feet. It projects a top speed of 130 miles per hour and can haul 3,500 pounds. Its battery is 400 volts and that's in line with the capability of most DC fast chargers in the US. It has a big battery that has 111 kilowatt hours of gross capacity, 107 kilowatt hours usable. The Polestar 3 has an 11 kilowatt onboard AC charger that's 48 amps. The full 48 amps would require a hardwired electric vehicle supply equipment on a dedicated circuit rated at 60 amps. The electric vehicle supply equipment that is provided with the car has a cable rated at 40 amps, and I presume this will work with any 240 volt option at home, even a NEMA 1450 plug point for level 2 charging. The equipment can be used on a level 1 regular 120 volt point at home or for portable use when traveling. The thing that got me curious was a fine print. The cable of the equipment is rated at 12 amps instead of the expected 15 amps available at level 1. Any which way, I presume, Polestar does not expect users to charge its 107 kilowatt hour usable battery at 12 amps and only expects its use in a real emergency. Even a 10% charge would take 6 hours at level 1. I will try and confirm this again in a future video, as the cable was not available when I checked the car. A point I will like my viewers to keep in mind. For DC fast charging, the Polestar 3 supports a max charge rate of 250 kW with a recommended daily charging limit of 80%. I have stated in a number of videos that what matters here is the charging curve. That's the duration in the charging session that an EV can hold its max charge rate. I expect it to be fairly good with the Polestar 3, but we can ascertain once I can check it myself. And even more importantly, if it can access a reliable DC fast charging network. The Polestar 3, currently made available in the US, has a CCS1 port. The Polestar 3 is available in two trims, both dual motor, but the second with a performance pack. On the key variables, the basic trim offers 489 horsepower and 620 pound-feet of torque, a 0 to 60 in 4.9 seconds, and an EPA rated range of 300 miles on 21-inch wheels. The second trim, the one with the performance pack, offers 517 horsepower and 671 pound-feet of torque, a 0 to 60 in 4.6 seconds and 270 miles of EPA rated range on 22-inch wheels. Interestingly, the Volvo EX90 that shares the chassis with this car has similar range numbers. That's interesting, as the EX90 is supposed to be far less efficient. And my feeling is the Polestar 3 will not exactly be very efficient on miles per kilowatt hour either. If at some point I bring this in my regular side-by-side comparison, it will surely be with the Volvo EX90. The Polestar 3 has a fully adjustable air suspension. The long-range dual motor is priced at $83,900 and the long-range dual motor with the performance pack is priced at $89,900 at the time of making this video. These are steeply high prices, way beyond any tax credit or other incentives currently available here in the US. With the lower trim only $3,900 away from the threshold, I won't be surprised if these prices update. It's also worth wondering who buying a $80,000 plus car will also be eligible for the tax credit. Those must be a very, very thin proportion of individuals or households. In June, Polestar has announced its intention to join Tesla's North American charging standard. But we don't know when the cars with the NACS port will be actually available. In all probability, they will be provided with an adapter once they are into NACS, until the first cars with the NACS port arrive. But this is a temporary solution. I would not recommend relying on DC fast charging adapters as the daily charging option. It's fine on a stray occasion, but would not recommend it as the primary and only method of DC fast charging. These adapters develop resistance over time and could pose a danger. In another development, the largest DC fast chargers in America, besides Tesla, that's Electrify America and EVgo, have recently updated their terms to prohibit third-party adapters. It's a separate issue, but going forward, they have disclaimed any liability from adapters that have not been provided by the car manufacturers. I don't think they have any way to stop users from using aftermarket third-party adapters. This does not include adapters provided by automakers themselves. But they have clearly put the onus of the hazard on the user. So it's going to be even tricky with DC fast charging until the car makers resolve the DC fast charging issue completely. It's an important aspect I will like my viewers to keep in mind. And now with a number of cars moving to NACS, I expect even more third-party adapters to hit the market. Many of very dubious quality but cheap prices. We also know that Tesla has promised to provide NACS adapters to non-Tesla brands that reach agreement with it. But the quantities of those is still uncertain and an issue that needs separate attention altogether. I'll try and make a separate video on this. Given that, Polestar has surely gone all out to give power to this system and a big battery pack. These details, as put out by the company, are all available on the Polestar website, and I'm leaving the link to the particular page in the description. I have put together the key variables here for an easy assessment. I have obtained some information additionally for the benefit of my viewers, that which was not available on the Polestar website, which I had to source from other places. But most of the factors can be verified on its website, and I urge viewers with interest to do the same. As usual, I recommend viewers verify all my content at their own discretion. I was unable to check its software, which is Google's Android Automotive, probably the version 11 or 12, which was unavailable at the time I was at Polestar. For closing thoughts, is the car a good design? Undoubtedly. Is the price good? I'm not sure, especially if one is to look at the current dynamics of the market and the options. The Polestar 3 will please the segment it's designed to please for sure. On the experience, appearance and driving feel, that I can place firmly without a mile under. But my true personal interest is in cars that are modest and actually help decarbonize by being available in numbers that make a difference. Taking away nothing from the experience this car promises and from its likely customers. Leave your comments and share your thoughts. Until the next one, take very good care.